Let me take some bread out. We are so glad you're here today. It is an exciting time to come together to worship our Lord. We are glad that you've joined us either in person. If you're joining us online, we are delighted that we have this ministry to be able to reach out to you. God is doing some great stuff. We are starting a three-week series today on the fall festivals of Israel, and I'm excited about what God's going to teach us, and I just want you to be known. Now, we'll get to all this in just a little bit, and let me move my machete and my hatchet to the side for a second, but I do have some announcements to call attention to. One, there is no children's activities tonight. There will be an adult Bible study, and I believe the College and Career as well has an event going on this evening. So I encourage the College and Career to have their event and the adult Bible study. We wrap up our entire series of 31 Signs of the End Times, and we will be in the sanctuary tonight. We have had the fellowship hall rewaxed and stripped and done some good work over there, and all that will be back into place by Monday. So we're just letting you know what's going on. Also, in your pew, something brand new, we have removed if you're a guest with us, we are delighted that you've been able to join us, and in the pews are a new welcome card, and I did this intentionally because I figured if you were bored, you could look at a picture of me, all right? So I put my little tiny little picture, take it home, put it on the mirror, you know, just encourage you and all that's going on. But no, it is one of these things, and this is how you do it. Just if you want to take a picture of the QR code, it'll take you online where you can register and let us know your prayer requests. Let us know a little bit more about you and that we're so excited and glad that you're with us. Also, in your bulletins, there is an insert. On this insert are some really great announcements. One is the outdoor movie night. That's coming up this Saturday night. This is a fundraiser for the Pregnancy Resource Center, and encourage you to be here. Info all on that, online and such as that. On the back is about our family gathering, our camp out. That's going to be right here at the church, the Friday, Saturday night. You see the information there. Matt Torrance and our missions teams are kind of getting that together. And it's all part of Sukkot. Not quite the exact dates, but close. Sukkot is one of the fall festivals we're going to be looking about. And one of the traditions is you camp out. And so the kids are going to be camping out. The families, we encourage families to camp out. Now, you may say, I do not want to camp out, but can I bring my RV up here? As long as our power grid will handle it, you can do whatever you want, okay? But know this, the church has no showers, and you are not coming into my house. Okay, we're just going to leave that one right out there. And then on the bottom is a little thing about a men's Bible study, a little short insert there that lets you know the great things that happen on our Wednesday night Bible studies. The women started their series the first and third Wednesdays every month, and the men's every week going on with the Bible study. The other week for women is mission studies, so it is something every Wednesday night. While your kids are having their mission activities, we have our events going on. Now, you see all that's going on in your bulletin, the things that are coming up. There is, you might have gotten in the mail this week, a letter from me that shared about We Want Your Stories. On the 26th of this month, we are celebrating our note burning. We're going to be celebrating a little bit impact of what God has been doing, and it's about the harvest, and it is about the seeds of the harvest. Now, it is about this building. This building has been paid off now for over a year now, but I want to collect stories of things that God has done in and through this building. Now, I have only been here for about 3 years, but some of you all have been here the entire span of this building. Some of you have been here the entire span of every building, okay, back to 1907. And I'm not going to mention Cecil by name. I keep saying that, okay? But it is this concept that we want your stories. Maybe your child was baptized here. Maybe you got married here. Maybe you remember a funeral, or maybe you remember a worship service that God just changed your life. Or how I got used during a tornado, the different events. How has God used this building? Not just this room, but think about the youth room as it has evolved and morphed over the years, and how many things that have gone on down there. Think about, you know, just the different places, the choir room, the different places in the lobbies, or just the building itself having been an image and a standard for God. I would love to hear your stories. Put those in writing. You can fill that letter we sent out. There's more. They'll be in the lobby. But we also, you can email me a story, whatever it's going to be. But I'm excited to see your stories. And I would love to do that. Now, yesterday a new mission opportunity came across my path. We've had so many people suffering. Ida with Louisiana to New York a few weeks ago, the flooding in central Tennessee. You have Haiti. You have other events that are just going around our country. We've had people right here in our community that are struggling. And I know what that is, but I'll get up there in a second. But it is one of those things. We got a brand new mission opportunity for Afghan refugees. Okay? And I've got some sheets down here, and there's some more in the lobby in the corner over there. But Virginia has a spot where about 20,000 plus Afghan refugees are coming. The Southern Baptist group, our SBCV, what we're part of, they are getting together some mission opportunities. We know that there's a church in Farmville that will be collecting supplies. We know they're going to be at Fort Lee. They're going to be they're near Quantico. All these different things going on. And you can contribute. Now, you can donate, and we'll collect. Our college and career are going to be collecting some of these items. Or maybe you're just an Amazon user. That SBCV has actually set up a wish list on Amazon where you can go in and purchase it straight from Amazon and have it mailed directly to their collection center. So if that's easier for you, whatever it might be, if you just want to donate money, whatever we do, we'll be funneling to the different organizations that are collecting either at Farmville or the SBCV in Richmond. But this gives you some information, and I know a very dire need is for especially young mothers and children, because some of these refugees are coming in, and some of them are having the births right here in America, and you've read the stories, births on the plane, all the different things going on. But what a great way for us as Baptists to share the love of Jesus Christ. Okay, this is not talking politics. This is not talking religion. One of the things about the Jewish culture, because we're going to be studying the Jewish culture, is they took care of the sojourners, the ministry of hospitality. And what a great opportunity for us to be ministers in missions. And I'm excited for that. So that is something I encourage you to be praying about. Our college, like I said, our college career are going to be involved. I ask our praise team to make their way up. And I'm just shocked today. I just want you to know it has been the first church service in a long time where this side has had more people than this side. Okay, I think that needs to be noted, all right? Yvonne's over there clapping. So let me start off with this. I got this in the mail yesterday. I ordered it from Israel. Part of Rosh Hashanah is the blowing of the shofar. And I want you to know, I went to seminary, I studied, and I am a skilled physician. I have no idea what that word means, okay? Let me just rephrase. I don't know what I'm going to do here because I've really never done this before. I've had exactly like 30 minutes of practice. But the blowing of the ram's horn is vital. So I want to start our worship service. Would we stand as we hear a call to worship, and then we're going to go straight into our singing. Don't laugh. Y'all need to sing, okay? Let's start off our singing. Take it away, praise team.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of their servant Moses, righteousness being restored. Temple. There's no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold, He comes.
Forever, I'll love you, forever, I'll
Would you be seated for just a second? One of the things that takes place through Rosh Hashanah is several scriptures being read, prayers being lifted, and in many ways, Jews are like Baptists, and they love to eat, all right? But one of the things they do is at certain parts and throughout the whole evening, special blessings will be done. The blessings are different, but they all include a phrase, Baruch Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam, which is this, Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe. It is this phrase that repeatedly just reminds us and ingrains in us that our God is one who is Lord over all, King of kings, and that he is blessed, and he is the one who gives out blessing. So I would like to read some blessings, and then at the end of each blessing, I would like for all of us to say these three lines. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe. All right? So let's stand as we do these blessings, and then we're going to go right into our final song that talks about this concept of who our great God is. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who has sanctified us with his commandments, has commanded us to kindle the light of day of remembrance. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine, who has chosen us from all nations, raised us above all tongues, made us holy through your works. And you, Lord our God, have given us this day of remembrance, this festival of holy assembly, a day for a sounding of the shofar, a holy assembly commemorating the exodus from Egypt. For you have chosen us, sanctified us, and your word, our King, is true and enduring forever. Who sanctifies Israel in this day of remembrance, who has granted us life, sustained us, and enabled us to reach this very occasion. You, O God, are the one who brings forth bread from the earth. You are the one who gives us fruit and sweetness of honey. So, Lord, we bless you, the creator of all. May it be your will to renew us for a good and sweet year in our Lord Yeshua the Messiah. And then they would blow the shofar. Let us sing.
Jesus, look for
Be seated. Kids, you're not dismissed yet. Okay, we've got some stuff to do before that, but we are so glad. I want to introduce the holiday here for a second. Rosh Hashanah literally means the top of the new year, top of the year. Rosh means head or first or top, and then Hashanah is the year. So it's top of the year. And where we would say happy, and you kind of go, Happy New Year, basically, in the middle of September. It is the first day of this month. But you have to understand, the Jewish culture had four New Years, all right? So they had a New Year for the feast, and they had for the priest and the tithe, all these different things. But this is a particular one, and it doesn't show up in Scripture. We're going to see a little bit more about that in a second. But there is a particular greeting that I want us to learn, and I've put the transliteration. It's La Shana Tova Tiki Tevu. Okay? I want us all to say that. Let's start with the first word first. La Shana Tova Tiki Tevu. All right? That basically means may you be inscribed for a good year. All right, now you have no idea what that means, but it is the greeting, and we're going to explain it in just a second. May you be inscribed for a good year. And then when someone says that to you, you would basically say, Gam lecha. All right, that's Klingon for, it's Hebrew. And to be fair, if there's anybody here that grew up in Israel that knows I'm pronouncing this wrong, just keep your mouth shut. Okay, let me just kind of believe I know what I'm doing here. I had many years of Hebrew language, but I've never been to Israel, so there's all this thing. But La Shana Tova Tiki Tevu, and this is the greeting. May you be inscribed for the new year. Now, new year, Rosh Hashanah, actually starts on this year. It's different because it goes with the lunar calendar. On sunset tomorrow night. And it goes through sunset on Wednesday night. So it is a 48-hour celebration. It is the new year where they would celebrate for the top of the year, where they kind of would start everything off. It is part of the first of the three festivals of the fall. And the Jews had several main festivals, and they both were tied around with the harvest. Now, part of what we're doing here is tying this into our harvest celebration on the 26th. But this is Rosh Hashanah, and it goes into the feast, and it's also called the Feast of the Trumpets, the Feast of the Day of Remembrance. And to really get this to be introduced, let me just show you from the Chosen People, which is a Jewish, Messianic Jewish organization, a short video that will give you a description. But before we go to the video, let's all say the whole three words together. Ready? One, two, three. La Shana Tova Tiki Tevu. All right, if you're watching online, we are not speaking in tongues. That was Hebrew. So let's watch this video to get a short introduction. Then after the video, our kids will be...
Tonight begins the two-day holiday of Rosh Hashanah, which is known as the Jewish New Year. Before the holiday begins, we would like to tell you what it is, how it is celebrated, and what it means for believers in Messiah. Rosh Hashanah is not mentioned by name in the Bible. Instead, we hear about the day of the blowing of the shofar, or the Feast of Trumpets. In chapter 23 of Leviticus, God commands the people of Israel that on the first day of the seventh month, they are to blow the trumpets, present an offering, and rest from their usual work. Rosh Hashanah is a happy holiday filled with celebration. During this day, people will blow a shofar or ram's horn in observance of the command to blow the trumpet. The shofar also serves as a reminder of God's kingship over Israel. Certain passages of Scripture are read during Rosh Hashanah. The most notable is Genesis 22, which tells the story of when God asked Abraham to sacrifice his only son, Isaac. Abraham brought Isaac up the mountain, bound him, and raised the knife to kill his son. And it was at this moment that God stopped Abraham and provided a ram to sacrifice in place of Isaac. This is why the ram's horn is also considered a symbol of God's provision. In addition to blowing the shofar, people will also eat particular foods during Rosh Hashanah, such as round challah bread, which symbolizes the never-ending cycle of years, apples with honey, which symbolize the hope for a sweet new year, and pomegranate seeds, which point to the numerous good deeds people plan to do in the new year. Another tradition associated with Rosh Hashanah is the Tashlich ceremony, which may take place in the afternoon or during the following 10 days of awe leading up to Yom Kippur. Tashlich is Hebrew for casting off, and during this ceremony, people will gather next to a body of running water, such as a river, and throw pieces of bread into the water. These pieces of bread symbolize what the prophet Micah says in chapter 7, verse 19. He will again have compassion on us. He will tread our iniquities underfoot. Yes, you will cast all their sins into the depths of the sea. Throughout all the traditions of Rosh Hashanah, we see echoes of the gospel story. The same way God provided the ram as a sacrifice for Abraham and Isaac, so too he provided his son, Yeshua, as the final sacrifice for our sins. Following Messiah makes our lives much sweeter as we face each new year and the obstacles that come with it. Finally, we will hear the trumpet blast when Yeshua returns, and all the believers who have passed away will rise from the dead and receive new bodies. As our Jewish brothers and sisters celebrate Rosh Hashanah, let's remember how blessed we are to belong to our Messiah and rejoice in knowing that He will return again soon.
At this time, we do dismiss our kids, and y'all are going to go through these doors down here, not the normal back door. So our kids are dismissed for children's church, and they're going to go that way. They still will come back at the pink room for dismissal. So kids dismissed, going down. And if you're remaining, if you would open up your Bibles to Leviticus chapter 23, I want to share with you a little bit about this festival. And as they slowly make their way down, so we're excited about that. It is interesting that all the festivals point to Christ. Now, in this particular festival, as he kind of talked about earlier, the festival of Rosh Hashanah is not mentioned in the Bible. It does not show up by that title. That title actually doesn't show up until about after the first century, after the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem, and they kind of were dispersed back into the diaspora, back into the synagogues and all across the globe. So it is that concept. Now, for the next 10 to 15 minutes, I'm going to be giving a lot of history, a lot of traditions, but we're going to see at the end of all this how all of this points to Jesus Christ. All this points to us about who our great God is. And I want us to be encouraged as through each of these that it not only points to Christ, it also challenges us how do we relate to Christ. Now, Leviticus 23, verses 23 through 32 are about the temple, about the Feast of the Trumpets. The trumpets play a very important part in Jewish culture. This actual shofar, which is a ram's horn, was made according to the same custom that's been done for over two millennia. It actually is made by a family that has been doing this type of artwork and this type of culture for over 400 years. And I ordered it, and I had several, and I've given them away, but I ordered this one. and I thought I was going to get it in time, and then the news said it has been delivered to New York, and then the storm hit, and I said, I'll never see it again, you know. And so I had lined up somebody to actually play the trumpet today, but then I got home last night about 6:30, and there it was. So God has a way of providing. It is this beautiful piece of work that when you go to the book of Numbers, you will see so much about the trumpet. And it talks about silver trumpets. It talks about this long. There are shorter horns, and we're not exactly sure everything. But the shofar is tradition that goes back way before the time of Christ. And the horn was used to call for battle, for war, to call to assembly. Today, we do very similar. At almost 10:45 today, most of you heard what? The bells clanging, calling us to come to worship. All right? And today, we don't necessarily use shofar. We use these type of things to grab your attention. All right? And I would do the siren, but some of you may have weak hearts, and I don't want to, you know, have to call in the EMT from that point. But this is what the purpose of the horn was. Get your attention. Call to assembly. Kind of a wake-up alarm clock for worship. And in this thing, I want us to read in chapter 23. And I don't know if that worked online or not. It kind of freaked him out there. But verse 23, it says this. The Lord spoke to Moses in all these festivals he's given them. Speak to the people of Israel, saying, in the seventh month, on the first day of the month, you shall observe a day of solemn rest, a memorial proclaimed with blast of the trumpets, a holy convocation. So he's calling them together. You shall not do any ordinary work. You shall present a food offering to the Lord. Again, what that basically means, we're having a cookout. Because many times when they gave food offering, part of it went to the offering, part of it went to the priest, and part of it you just had a family cookout. All right, so this is an early barbecue, all right? So you shall, totally lost my place here. You shall not do any work, and you shall present a food offering to the Lord. And the Lord spoke to Moses. Now, on the 10th day of the seventh month is the day of atonement, and it shall be for you a time of holy convocation, and you shall afflict yourselves to present a food offering to the Lord. So here is this point. Rosh Hashanah is the first of the fall feast, and it is a wake-up call to wake up, have a solemn rest, a holy convocation, and you are to have this food offering. And of all the traditions, many have been added through the centuries, of all the traditions, the ram's horn is the most important. The ram's horn is, you are calling them to convocation. And the ram's horn represents several different things. And there were several different types. So I'm going to try again. There are four different types of blows, I guess if that's the actual term, that you would do. All right? The first one should be like this shorter, almost a sobbing type of thing. And so it is. It's like you're the flow goes through it. And then you would have three short wails. Not whales fish, but, you know. And then, now these would be scattered out through the entire service, the entire meal. And after each part, I'm kind of doing them all at the same time. And then you would do these nine piercing staccato. And this is the hard one for me. I have to kind of make this up because I didn't know what the word staccato meant. Okay, I thought it was a certain type of heel on a lady's shoe. But, you know, that didn't work either, so we're just going to kind of go with that. And if that's, you know, but then the blower would drink water. Oh, okay. And if that wasn't enough, at the very close, you would have a long tikiah, which is basically they say you blow the horn as long as you can. And I add the phrase, until you pass out. All right? This is basically saying, worship is over, go home and eat. All right? So. Oh, that's enough. Okay. Okay. I'm a little lightheaded right now. But so, in all this aspect, the thing I want you to grasp here is when it comes to these festivals and feasts, The shofar is a very important part of the Jewish tradition. And it basically is wake up. Now, there are traditions behind the shofar that go back way through history. And I'll kind of get to those in just a second. But mainly the part of it is a call to what we call the Yamim Nara'im, which are the days of awe. Rosh Hashanah is the first day, and then 10 days later, you do Yom Kippur, which we know is called the Day of Atonement. And that is probably one of the highlights, next to Passover, huge in a way that it points to Christ. And we're going to hit that next week. But those 10 days are the days of awe, where you've got 10 days to get right with God. Now, before I jump to that, because I'm kind of jumping ahead of myself, let me go back and explain a little bit. But to do this next explanation about some of the traditions here, I need two people. So, Gabby, come on up. Yeah, your dad said I could call on you. All right. And do we have a coach from a football team that played Appomattox this week? Come on, yeah, come on. I want you to come up. And I want to know, Donna, and I've been wondering all week, who did you pull for? Okay, because Donna has grandkids on y'all's team and cheerleader grandkids on the Appomattox. All right, your dad said you had no food allergies?
No, I'm allergic.
You're allergic to everything. Does he have any food allergies? Got that, okay? Now, so we need to slice up some food. No, I'm not going to use that. So. But I thought it would be kind of cool. I really don't know how to do this. But one of the things that they would do is behind there is, there should be a bowl. There's some bowls and stuff. All right. There, grab two of those. And I will clean up. Yes, I will. All right. One of the traditions is you would eat apples with honey. And I know we have a family that actually makes honey, but I didn't get any of the Hodges, so. And the tradition would be, one of the blessings that we kind of read was, you would take the apple, and you would dip it in the honey, and they would say the blessing of how God is sweet. So, take a slice. All right, wait, take your bowl. Wait a minute, don't eat it yet. Blade is sharp. There you go. And you would say, thank you, God, to make this year sweet. So go ahead. Okay? And you just have to eat one bite. You don't have to eat the whole thing, though. You can go for it if you want to. These are one of my favorite apples. It's called Envy. I don't know if you ever had Envy apples. All right? Now, the other thing, tradition on Monday, the second night, is you would try a new fruit. All right? So this year, I've got plumquats. You ever had a plumquat? I don't think that's going to work. So take a plumquat, and you're still eating. You're going to, and just take a little bite of the plumquat. You don't have to do honey. Just a little bite. It is part plum, part apricot. It's not good. Throw it back in the bowl. It's okay. That's why y'all seems lost. all right. Well, throw it in the bowl just because I got more for you. Okay. And then another type of thing is, interestingly, this is what I really don't know how to slice, is the pomegranate. All right. Who here likes pomegranate? Anybody here know how to slice a pomegranate? Thank you. Okay. Neither do I. They say, first of all, you throw it on the ground and stomp on it. They say what you do is you slice it from head to toe, top to bottom, all right, and rip it apart, and then you would squeeze it. To get all the seeds out. I'm not going to make you eat this. But the concept of pomegranate, you put the bowl up. The concept of pomegranate is it's sweet, it's different. You're supposed to try something new during the year, all right? And pomegranate is very special because, one, it has 613 seeds. I don't know who counted. Thank you. I don't know who actually counted that. But it goes with the 613 commandments, the mitzvot, that they have. So you would eat that. And then the last thing you would eat is matzah bread. Now, I had a hard time finding matzah bread because, to be fair, I didn't find matzah bread. But this is chocolate bread. I'll give you the rest of the buns when we're done, okay? That is braided. Now, normally you would find it in a roll already. So the concept is God is eternal. And you would give a blessing over the matzah bread that he is the God of creation and the God of the harvest. And it is eternal, his love and his passion. So that is the food. I will give you the rest of that to share with your dad who volunteered you. He ain't getting none of that. Give these guys a hand, will you? Okay. Yeah. I didn't realize these things are so... How do you eat these things? You eat the seeds? Oh, that makes more sense. And it is rather messy, but I do have plates and everything up, except for the hatchet and the machete. So we're just going to throw those back with the praise team. So you would do these special foods, and they would send out. Now, to be honest, don't we do the same thing? How many of you on January 1st would eat cabbage or black-eyed peas? He says no. So now you can actually eat honey and apples and pomegranate seeds, okay? I got a new tradition for you. And it is this concept of blessing and being God is the blessing, okay? So it is this fruit. And you would have fun with this. This is kind of a silly thing that happened where the pomegranate, because of so many seeds, represented fertility. More kids. You didn't eat the pomegranate, did you? Okay. All right. And it goes to the 630 mitzvot, but you also would have fun with the fruit. So it almost like this part of the holiday was made for dads. How many dads here love dad's jokes? All right. So you would eat raisins, and you would say, we're raising expectations for the new year. You would eat lettuce, and you would say, let us find happiness for the new year. You would eat beets and say, let us beat back any obstacles in the new year. You would eat bananas, and you say, let's hope this year is appealing. I made that last one up. But those first, that's what you would do. Basically, you try something new, and you symbolize that God is the God of newness and new beginnings. And so fruit and honey and apple especially are a huge part of this holiday. And you're going to get to next week. Interestingly, with Yom Kippur, you're going to find it's more with citrus. We're going to get to that next week. Now, another thing that it is connected with is water. You saw in the video, there was a tradition called the Tishlik, which is Hebrew means casting. You see the Hebrew word up there. And the casting is, you would go, and it started, this is not in scripture at all right? But it started around the 13th century. And you would go down to the river, and it started where you would just empty your pockets, and you would cast it into the river and let it flow away, all right? But it's supposed to be running water. All right, don't throw it into your sink at home. It's supposed to be running water. The aspect of just from Micah chapter 6, where it says that, you know, he cast our sins into the ocean and they're gone. And it is this concept of, Micah chapter 7. He will again have compassion on us. He will tread our iniquities underfoot. You will cast all our sins into the depths of the sea. And this tradition of casting off, and it is this point, you're moving into something new. And to be honest, this should be every Sunday in the Lord's Day. It should be the start of something new. That we forget, what did Paul say? We forget what is behind us and we press forward. No regrets, no past tense. We're all forgiven. We start fresh. We don't hold on to our victories. We don't hold on to our defeats. It is a new year, and we press forward. And it is running water, and there's actually a Jewish tradition, and I think this one was started by William Page. He's not here today, so I can pick on him. It is this aspect, the water is supposed to have fish in it, because it is to be a reminder that just like the fish is at any given moment could be caught by the fisherman, so too we in our journey could be caught and judged by God. So always be prepared. So this water. Now, another part of water is, there is a Jewish myth, folklore, that and part of this whole story ties to Abraham and what is called the Akedah, which is the binding, where Abraham bound Isaac up on the mountaintop, and he was going to sacrifice Isaac, if you know that story. And there is this folklore that as Abraham was going up the mountain, Satan was kind of getting into his head, all right? Kind of, don't do this, you know, you're no good, you're going to kill your son, trying to make Abraham stop before he got to the mountaintop. And when he couldn't get Abraham's brain all messed up, what he did is he started water to come down from the mountains. And there was this rushing river. And it got all the way up to Abraham's neck. And finally, Abraham cried out, "Oh God, help me." And instantly the water stopped and receded, and Abraham was rescued. And it is this picture, as we cast our sin to the water, no matter what Satan is doing to us, it's going to go downstream, and we need to let it go. It actually could be where the song "Let It Go" from Frozen came from. Just let it go. All right, just let it go. All right, from this aspect. And so in this point, water is very, very unique. And another, speaking of Satan, another thing about the ram's horn, a tradition is part of the ram's horn is, as they blew the horn, especially the staccato, it would confuse Satan. Satan was in heaven bringing accusations against God's people, and the ram's horn was one way of confusing Satan. So all these come down to this aspect. Which brings us to one more tradition called the Teshuvah. The Teshuvah was repentance, to turn around, to repent. And basically it's this. You are these call to remembrance, the call to trumpets, the call to assemble, the day of remembrance. You are to remember what is behind you. And you are to get right with God. You have 10 days of awe to get right with God. Because one of the symbols was the two books. And I have two books here. And there would have been, we're going to call this, the black book, the book of the wicked. All right, the book of the wicked. Now it's empty, because every year it would be empty. But then there's also the book of life. Now the book of life is mentioned in Scripture at least a half a dozen times. There are several other books. And the principle here is this. You have 10 days before the day of awe to make sure your name is written in the book of life. All right, now, I'm not giving what necessarily Scripture here. I'm giving the Jewish tradition, okay? So you have 10 days to get ready to make sure your name. And if you messed up anywhere, you do teshuva. You do, and there's another word called, I'm trying to remember what it is now. Where you confess. I confess I beat that horse. I confess I stole my neighbor's, you know, flowers. I confess that I thought bad thoughts against my spouse. I confess that I was bitter, or I was jealous, or I covet, or I took the Lord's name in vain. You would make all these confessions, and you would get right with God, and at the end of the 10 days, if you had gotten right with God, your name would be written in the book of life, and then the book would be sealed until next year. And if you're not in the book of life, David Detweiler. Okay? Todd Estes, your name would be written in the book of the wicked. Now, here's the scary part. If you die sometime in the next 12 months before the next Rosh Hashanah, and your name is in this book, there was no hope. Your fate was sealed. Now, so the days of awe. You know, the video made it sound like this is a celebration. And it was, man. You had food, you had festival, you had worship, you had great music. But then all of a sudden, you got 10 days to get right with God. And if you don't, be very careful for 12 months. All right? These are some of the traditions. And on Yom Kippur, they are sealed. Now, all this is just tradition. But there is things in Scripture that Rosh Hashanah and the Feast of Trumpets are very clear about in how they point to God. So I want to give you six things of how I gleaned and how I think we can glean from this holiday and from Scripture itself about God and about this festival. And so the next slide is this. First of all, God is king over all. There is. What was the phrase we read earlier? That he is the king over the universe, the king of all. I mean, he is the Lord God, our king. In Psalm 47:2, and Psalm 47 was one of the psalms, it's this: "For the Lord, the Most High, is to be feared. a great king over all the earth. Psalm 47:2. And so the trumpet is blown, and all through last year, you see how God worked. And I beg you to try this and look over the last year and see that God was there. And if you try to prove that God wasn't there, it's not possible, because everywhere along the path, we see God work. Even in the tragedies, even in the hardships, God was there. God is king over all there is. But the other point, the next point is this: you need to be ready. We need to be ready. There is always, when you hear that trumpet, are you ready? And we're going to hear something very specific about the trumpet in the middle. But in the book of Nehemiah, they celebrate the Feast of Trumpets there in Nehemiah, in the city of Jerusalem, as he's rebuilding the walls. And he says, they start mourning because they start to remember. And Nehemiah says, stop your mourning. He said, this is a time of celebration because we see God is at work and God is here. So go home, spend time with your family, worship and celebrate. Be ready and know that God is always on the throne. So Mark 1:15 about being ready. The first thing that we see Mark recorded about Jesus was this. His preaching was this: repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. And you want to know the way to be ready? It is repent. Teshuva, to turn away from your old ways and be ready. I know if God came right now, you'd feel kind of good. Man, I'm at church. I'm worshiping. But what did you do Friday night? Okay, forget the football game for a second. What did you do Saturday afternoon or sometime this week? Was there a time in the last 7 days where you say, man, if God had come at that moment, I would have been embarrassed. I would have been shamed. The point about, even Jesus says, be alert. Be vigilant. Keep eyes out. Be wary. We need to be ready. And as other places in Scripture, it says this: today is the day of salvation. Don't hold off tomorrow, because you do not know what tomorrow holds. 3, Christ is coming again. 1 Corinthians 15 says this: behold, I tell you a mystery, Paul is writing. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. The trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. I don't know about you, but there is something, and I know the ram's horn is nothing more than a horn from an animal, okay? But just the connection to Scripture, the connection to being alert, being ready, it is a spiritual wake-up call. Every time it should be, are we ready that when that trumpet it calls, we know Christ is coming again. Be ready for that. 3 more things I want to challenge you with. The next one is this: He is a God of new beginnings. He is a God of second chances and third chances and fourth chances and fifth chances. And no matter how much you've messed up your life, no matter how much you think you've fallen short and you think you are unworthy, you are unworthy. But God is the God of second chances. And He says, I love you. Throughout Scripture, we see David returning after being confronted with the sin of Bathsheba. The beautiful passage of Psalm 51. We see the prodigal son being welcomed by the father. We see Jesus at the very point of death. He tells the thief, today you'll be with me in paradise. We see the one who prosecuted, jailed and killed Christians in the name Saul is one who God called to be His voice. God is a God of second chances, and He can use anything and anyone. And in this concept, we need to remember He is the God of new beginnings. And just like the Tashlik, let it go. Let your past go, forgetting what lies behind, and we press forward. We are also not made acceptable by our actions. And I want to tell you this. No matter what you do, think you deserve to get out of the book of the wicked, you do not deserve to get out of the book of the wicked. You cannot confess enough, repent enough, do enough good works, buy your way out of this book into this book. Paul said in the book of Titus, He saved us not because works done by us in righteousness, but according to His own mercy by the washing of regeneration and the renewal of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior. We are, to put it in the vernacular of a hymn, we are washed by his blood. And that's what saves us. And the names that are already written in the Lamb's Book of Life, as you see in the book of Revelation, are not there because of anything we did, but because of everything he did. God made us acceptable by his methods, not our own. And lastly, it's this. We reflect upon the substitutionary atonement. One of the beautiful pictures of the story of Abraham is they were up on the mountain, and at the very moment where Abraham was lowering the blade to kill his child, the child that was supposed to be the lineage through God would work. And the angel of the Lord stopped his hand, but then what happened? In the thicket, they saw the ram. God provided a substitutionary sacrifice. So one of the beautiful pictures of when we see the ram's horn, we are reminded of the ram that was in the thicket of Abraham, and it substituted for his son Isaac. Today we are reminded that Jesus is our substitutionary atonement. For he made him who knew no sin to become sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. That's just one of hundreds of verses that point to that Jesus paid the price for you and for me. So as our praise team comes back up, I've got one question. Where we cry out, Jesus Christ, behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. We see Jesus is that Lamb that we see. The Rosh Hashanah is the call to be ready, the call to be right, the call to get right with God. It is this. Are you ready? Are you? If the trumpet of God were to cry out today and he would call his children home, would you be ready? I'm not saying would you be perfect, because you won't be. I'm not saying will you be, you know, doing everything you're supposed to be, because we all mess up and make mistakes. But do you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior? That is the only thing that gets us into heaven. So I ask the question, are you ready? And this song is a powerful song that says, I will run to the Father. What a great image to say, God, no matter what, you are king over all the universe. And there you are, the God of new beginnings. And I run to you. Let's stand. If you need someone to pray with you, if you feel this church is where God wants to be part of, but most important, if you want to be, make sure you're ready. I'm down here to share a little bit more about that. Let's sing.
I've carried a burden for too long on my